We have a very distinguished group, and what I was going to do is lead off with one question. We'll start at Dave Dreisinger on the left. Work. Everybody can answer the same question, and then we'll start with Cameron on the right and work back with the second question. And then Paul will take over the second half. So Dave, I guess if you could lead off with what is unique about your process.
Okay, thanks, Alistair. Well, our process is the search minerals direct extraction process. What we've tried to do with this technology is dramatically simplify the extraction of rare earths from our ore. We have the Foxtrot deposit in Labrador, which is about a 1% grade of rare earths with about a 20% heavy component to it. So it's a nice little ore body, multiple ore bodies actually on the same site as well that Randy Miller, our geologist, has been discovering. We went through the sort of the standard method of beneficiation, leaching, purification, and recovery of a rare earth product to begin with. We found that, of course, with the beneficiation process, there's flotation, magnetic separation, gravity, all sorts of technologies to bring to bear, but a lot of complexity and a lot of challenges to make that work effectively. We went back and decided to do something much simpler, which was just to make the material into basically coarse sand and directly treat it with acid in a very mild temperature baking process, about 200 degrees Celsius, and found that instead of having to go through all that beneficiation work, we could directly extract the ore with very low reagent consumption, with about a 70% recovery just by direct acid treatment. We found that that has given us a real advantage in terms of simple, low-risk technology, and something that's very scalable, so you don't have to build a large beneficiation plant to make it economic. We can actually do it at a much smaller scale because it's so simple. So we think we can have a small, efficient plant with a very simple technology.
Okay. Jay?
Okay, yeah, we're developing the Bear Lodge project, good and bad in the U.S. Good place to have a mine, a tough place to have a mine environmentally. So we've designed our process similar to Dave's. So we've got a bastnaesite ore, very, very fine rare earth minerals, 20, 30 microns. So we also concentrate into a sand. We do a relatively warm 45 degrees centigrade acid leach. From there it goes to a precipitation step to pull out the rare earths and the thorium as an oxalate. And then as of last night, we announced, or this morning I should say, our zero discharge solvent extraction process. It's important that we have environmentally sound process, zero discharges, recycles of all the reagents. And that's probably one of the biggest benefits of our process is that we are able to recycle every one of our reagents and have a zero discharge.
Carol Mugerman from Geomega Resources. We are developing a rare earth project in Quebec. It's a carbonatite. Main focus is on neodymium and praseodymium, the magnetic rare earths that we've been discussing here. We do have as well a niobium component, so just looking at neodymium, praseodymium, niobium and europium, we are looking at around 85% of the value being just in those four elements. The main focus over the last year, something that we just published in May of this year, was the hydrometallurgical process that we developed in-house. That was a hydromet process that now allows us to treat our ore with 58 kilograms of HCl, which is a very interesting low value that helps us reduce the electrical consumption on site to below 60 megawatts, so allows us to connect to the power line. That's on the project side. Now, in terms of separation technology, Geomega started developing a separation technology a couple of years ago. It's based on electrophoresis. Electrophoresis is something not that we imagined. It exists in the biochem industry, and we are working on the scale up of applying it into the mining industry. And the advantages of this technology so far, what we were able to demonstrate was it's a simultaneous separation of all the rare earth elements, including the impurities, so it does not have the same issues dealing with the impurities as solvent extraction does. And in addition, heavies are actually easier to separate than the lights, something that we don't usually hear in this industry. And we are working on the modular design, so we don't have to start working right away with a huge scale where it requires very high capex to get into production. So those are the three main points of electrophoresis.
Thank you. Neil?
Yes, I'm Neil Eisen from IBC Advanced Technologies. And I would say that the main advantage that we have is selectivity. And to explain that, I maybe go into just a short history. IBC is a leader in the development and commercialization of molecular recognition technology, which was originally developed back in the late 60s, 70s by three chemists who won the Nobel Prize in 1987, Francis Lane, Donald Cram, and Charles Pedersen. And IBC has taken that technology, which is based on supramolecular chemistry, it's a very selective type of chemistry, and been able to commercialize that in the metals industry. And so we have a rich history of developing and commercializing this separations technology in metals, in platinum group metals, in base metals, in the copper industry, in the cobalt industry, for acid mine drainage recovery. And the key advantage is selectivity. We use supramolecular chemistry, which is functionalized beads which go into resin columns. So it looks much like, if you would, an ion exchange column, but it has beads that have been functionalized by this molecular recognition chemistry. And what that allows us to do is come in and actually design the chemistry so that it can recognize and bind to particular metals that we want, that are of interest to capture. And so this is commercialized technology. It's being used by major metals companies throughout the world. The key advantage that selectivity gives is that you have very high capacity for the metal of interest. You're able to take it and recover it at high purity and high recovery rates. At IBC, about a year ago, we formed an alliance with UCOR Rare Metals in the rare earth element space. And subsequent to that, we have demonstrated on the laboratory scale the separation of the complete suite of 16 rare earth elements. We've been able to, we took the PLS, which is from the Bokan Mountain facility in Alaska, from the UCOR's mine, and we took a PLS from that and used our molecular recognition process to separate those 16 rare earth elements out at greater than 99% purity and at higher than 99% recovery. And so that was quite significant. We're now going into pilot, and we expect to have that pilot completed up and running at the in the first quarter of next year.
Okay, thank you. Patrick?
I'm Patrick Wong from Innovation Metals. I guess what's unique about us is that there isn't much unique about us. We've
been focused on rare earth separation. We do not own a mine, but we do have some interesting funders. Our technology and our research has been funded by the U.S. Department of Defense. We're not a public company, so we haven't press released out anything, but we have we're the first in North America that we know of to produce high purity dysprosium and terbium in a commercial process. We've taken technology that China uses today, and we've simulated it. It took us over a year to do it because we basically just built one circuit and we reused it over and over again for all, as you go down the SX circuits. We've also developed a new technology that is still uses solvent extraction as the basis. And it's actually quite amazing. It reduces our CapEx by over 90%. Our OpEx is measured in maybe $2 a kilo. The medium that we use is extremely cheap, doesn't wear out, so our OpEx costs are really low. We're really excited about it. The tests are ongoing right now. I was just in the plant today. It's in Mississauga, so if anyone wants to drop by and see it, they can. But again, it uses solvent extraction, the overall basis for it. yeah, we've achieved some really good results so far, and we'll continue to go forth.
Thank you. Wes?
Yeah, I'm Wes Berry with K Technologies. K-Tech was a company, it's over 20 years old, and we were formed primarily to focus on a core technology around continuous ion exchange and continuous chromatography. A lot of that work started in 1983, and a predecessor company, which was when continuous ion exchange was really first developed, not simulated, but continuous. And back in the 80s, we did quite a bit of work on rare earth separations, up to and including a pilot plant operation. I continued in the mid-90s on rare earth separations, but then, as most of you remember, in the mid-90s, the commodity markets all went down in the basement. So nothing really happened since then, but K-Tech had continued to focus on applications of continuous ion exchange and continuous ion chromatography. And there are several companies that are involved in it. And after 1983, the technology became more invested, I guess, or integrated into existing hydrometallurgical operations. It's used in food separations, hydromet separations, fertilizer production. There's a number of large-scale systems. So we got back into rare earth separations recently, about a year and a half ago, with Texas Rare Earth. And the basic process approach that we have is we use a continuous ion exchange system to initially take a relatively impure PLS, remove the rare earths and reject the impurities. We then take this rare earth concentrate or rare earth mixture and we go through successive continuous ion chromatography techniques, of which most of the chemistry was developed back in the mid-1940s by Oak Ridge and Ames for the nuclear program. But unfortunately, the only thing available at that time was fixed bed ion exchange. So we've taken and adapted well-established chemistry to a well-established equipment system and have come up with the three-stage approach, which offers considerably lower capital and lower operating costs.
Okay. Just before Cam speaks, for a matter of full disclosure, I am a technical advisor to rare earth salts, just so that there's no hidden agendas.
And a great one. Thanks, Alistair. First off, I do want to thank Tracy for putting this event together today and providing the platform for all of us to speak. I think it's great to get the industry together with such important people. We operate in a very sort of different mindset. I mean, from the get-go, what we tried to do is, operate under the fundamental belief that if you can't compete economically with the Chinese and the way that they separate, you're not going to live and you're not going to be around. And that has been the driving force behind everything that we have done and the mindset we have built. We have developed a new proprietary technology that has effectively separated all 16 rare earths, that includes yttrium and scandium, to high purity. We've done so at levels that are at least cost competitive to Chinese solvent extraction. That is environmentally friendly, and we have basically quantitative recovery. We're very excited with our progress. We are now currently testing a commercial size cell. I'm going to manage expectations here. We should have final data within the next 60 days, at which point we believe that will fundamentally eliminate any scalability issues. What we have seen at each, every time we've scaled up, we've seen better results. And there's no reason why we don't expect to see that with our final testing and final results of our commercialized cell. Finally, a couple of extra points. Our CapEx is a fraction of that of solvent extraction. So we think we're using off-the-shelf equipment. It's going to significantly reduce the cost up front, and it's deposit agnostic. So essentially, we've worked on with samples from more than 40 deposits around the world. We can essentially blend them together and separate them without any impact on results. I think that's a good initial summary. Thanks, Alistair.
Fair enough. Before we move on, are there any questions to any of the panel members about their specific project or process?
I guess the question is, what's the principle of our technology? It is not solvent extraction. Our founder of the technology, Dr. Joseph Brewer, evaluated essentially every processing technique going back 70 plus years and landed on this proprietary technology. What I'll say is our highest cost is electricity. We're not willing to get into technological discussions today unless we're under NDA. However, I'm happy and welcoming of anybody to come visit our facility. There have been people here who have seen it, and we welcome anybody to come visit us under NDA.
I think the other question I have for the panel, I'll work it backwards, is what's the biggest challenge to go to commercialization? Is it funding? Is it scale up? Is it finding partners?
It's a great question. For us, I think at this stage, it is finalizing our raise for a commercial demonstration facility. We do have a letter of intent, but we do need to close that off. It is certainly a difficult funding environment. We have secured feedstock. We believe, again, we will have eliminated scalability issues within 60 days. We have, as I said, feedstock. So it really does come down to financing, I think, from our perspective. And hopefully we will have eliminated that in the relatively near future.
Yeah, I think from our standpoint, funding is probably the main issue. We have, as I indicated, we had done considerable pilot plant work in the past, and the scale-up of the equipment systems are well established. The raw materials that we use are readily available. Our ion exchange resins and sorbents, again, are manufactured by multiple sources. So basically our next step is to move into a pilot, a larger pilot program, and that's what everybody has is funding.
Patrick?
I think funding it to a certain extent, I just actually received a quote, a revised quote for our pilot plant. It's actually gonna cost us less than 100 grand to build. One circuit, that's all that's needed to sort of prove it up. Solvent extraction doesn't have issues in scaling. For us, waiting for feedstock, I guess, but we already have suppliers of feedstock. So we're hoping to actually get into production next year.
Okay,
I'll kind of address that by saying that we've already achieved commercialization in a number of metals areas. I mentioned platinum group metals. We have one of the largest companies in the world, Impala Platinum in South Africa, who uses this technology to refine all of their palladium, which is quite significant. We've got customers in Japan, Tanaka Kikinzoka is another company, a major metals company, who uses our technology in the copper industry. Asarco, at their refinery in Amarillo, Texas, they use the MRT system for recovering bismuth out of copper. I guess Jack would call that a technology metal, I'm not sure. But bismuth is pretty important, and it's important to get that out of the copper refinery, electrolyte. So to answer your question, I think we've overcome and we're commercial technology at this point. Now to address the rare earth space, we put in place an agreement with and a partnership with UCOR. We have that. We've demonstrated on the lab scale that we've developed the ligands and been able to separate these metals, all 16 of them, to these high purities. So once that's really the hard part, is to develop the ligand technology, or the chemistry, if you will, that can accomplish the selective binding. And so we've done that. We've shown on the lab scale that works. We're going to pilot, so I guess I would answer that we need to execute our strategy, which is to complete the pilot, demonstrate that, and then get to the commercial system. But having said that, we've done this over and over again in the metals industry. Once we've got the ligand, we've shown it works at lab scale, we've been able to scale that up to full-scale commercial application.
Yeah. Kirill?
Well, I guess when you start with the technology that was used in the biochem sector, and the scale is not really mining appropriate, so taking it from that scale to our scale, that's the main challenge. And we identified the main challenges, the main boxes, and it's going one by one, answering all the questions, getting all the data in order to not make mistakes, because if you make mistakes and you have to go back, it's just costing you extra money, extra time, and that takes us back to the funding question. So I guess it's really ticking off all the boxes carefully one by one, answering all the questions that we asked ourselves. And so it's a question of time and really get at the end of the day getting to that commercialization scale.
Okay, Jay?
Yeah, I think funding is everybody's issue in the junior market. Our plan is to de-risk. We just finished our separation pilot plant last week over at SGS, where we're able to pull out cerium with one mixer settler, thorium with two mixer settlers. Stripping was done outside of solvent extraction. So I think we're on a path where we've changed the Chinese technology for separation by using smaller equipment, less equipment, and found a way around solvent extraction. Now we want to scale it up to a demonstration size plant. And our next step is to go into lanthanum and seg and apply the same reagents and techniques that we've used for the cerium and thorium. So scalability, yes, but keep on proving what we can do with our technology.
Okay, David?
Yeah, Alistair, our approach is, of course, we're working from the ore through to a mixed oxide currently. We're hoping to start another pilot plant program by the end of the year. So that'll be an integrated pilot plant right from ore to final mixed rare earth oxide with all the purification steps in between. We're currently doing a scoping study with one of the engineering and mining houses to make sure that we get our cost structure correct, and then expect to go through the PFS and the BFS after that. I think for us it's a question too of size. You know, the days of investing $1 billion in a rare earth plant is probably long gone. 100 million might be about the right size. But $1 billion is not going to be available. So we have to have a technology and a project that fits in that sort of space that's financeable. And we think that scaling down or scaling the project to just the right size is an important part of our path to development. The last couple of challenges, of course, are offtake and finance. So where does the product go, and who's going to finance us through to production?
Okay, thank you. As an observation, if we had had this conversation 5-7 years ago, it would all have been about the rocks in the ground, and then it sort of moved to making concentrate. Now we have 7 people up here talking about separation technology, so there's been a definite evolution in the industry. The question I throw out to the panel is, Linus has been successful in establishing a profitable business outside. In my view, there's maybe room for 2 or 3 more outside of China. What makes you guys think that you can be one of those 2 or 3? And we'll start. Well, or I can just throw it open.
Yeah, I'll speak first. I think it's the right size. You know, if we can get a project that's in the couple $100 million range to get through to production, I think we're in the right size. We're not market disruptive at that scale. We're probably about 2,000 to 3,000 tons per year of mixed rare earths with the heavy weighting again. So I think that getting the right size and getting through quickly is probably going to be the advantage that we would have at Surge.
Yeah, I think, you know, the days of building a single train plant of a large scale is long gone.
Yeah, I agree to that too, Alistair. I think it's the fundamentals of mining. Good deposit, location, grade, metallurgy, all those things add up, and low cost. I mean, we have to compete with Amanda and her group and the Chinese and everybody else, and we have to do it, get competitive, better and cheaper. So, and then everybody here with a mine isn't going to be here at some day. Like you said, 2 or 3 will make it, or less, at some point.
Kirill, what makes G-Omega?
Well, I'd say, have to look at it maybe from a little bit of a different perspective. I've been following that sector for quite a few years now, and analyzing each one of the companies, each one of the feasibility studies and everything that's been published out there. And you're totally right that we used to talk about, oh, it has to be the highest grade, or it has to be the biggest, or it has to be critical rare earths, the highest level of the critical rare earths, or it's only the magnetics. No, we are totally in a different situation right now. Linus, it's great that they made it there and they're producing. But for the next guy to come in, he needs to probably figure it out how to start entering the market even before building the mine, because no matter what's the scale of the mine, whether it's a couple hundred million or who knows, maybe somebody can come up with the right scale of, oh, it's just a hundred something. But is there a hundred something million right now today at this high risk environment where nobody wants to put CapEx money to build? So you have to figure out a different way. I really think with GeoMega, with the separation technology that we have, we are developing something that can be applied from a modular point of view, and modular, I think, is quite important. I think a few guys here mentioned the same thing. You want to start small, and you want to be flexible. You don't want to be able to treat only your concentrate coming out from your mine. It has to be adjustable to other feeds. Can it be a concentrate coming out of China, or at least to be able to demonstrate that you can process it on a regular basis? Or can it be some other concentrate coming out of somewhere else? The more flexibility that you offer, the more access, the more penetration you'll have into the market. So I think that's something that GeoMega, with our technology, we see that we can offer that flexibility. And by adjusting to what's available there on the market, you can probably enter the market.
Okay.
Yeah, in our case, I think we have the key pieces in place to be successful. Our partner UCOR has a world-class mine deposit in Volcan Mountain in Alaska. It's in a really great location. It's right on the ocean, on the Pacific Rim, and it is a U.S. Owned, you know, it's a U.S. territory deposit. They have done a lot of work on the beneficiation and on the leaching part of the process. IBC has done the work on the recovery of the metals. So we know all those technologies work. We know they can be scaled up because we've done that throughout the mining industry. And we can recover those metals at high purity and high recoveries. Also, we have UCOR has a large part of the financing in place, as they have partnered with the state of Alaska, which is a wonderful partner, and they've committed several hundred million dollars to the project. So that is in place, and so I do think we have a lot of the key success factors that are in place to go ahead and be successful.
Okay, Patrick.
Well, I think it's important to distinguish, though, you know, the difference between the light and heavy rare earth mines. I think one of the problems that Lynas and Molycorp fail into is the fact that they don't have the element composition that can keep them afloat or make them wildly profitable. For us, it's important that we're not a mine; we're an independent processing company. So our customers are the mines and the end users. Our job is to help mines get financed through long-term offtake contracts. We have reserved a lot of our capacity for our own purchases. We make way more money purchasing off our own, processing it, and selling it. But we are willing to enter into tolling agreements with mines. That should help a number of these mines, especially some of the private ones, and some of the ones with smaller footprints and much lower capex, stuff just right off the top.
Fair enough. What?
Yeah, I think a key part of our technology, well, we're tied in with Texas Rare Earth, so the ore source is there, and it has that high percentage of heavies. With the process technique that we're using, we get the impurities away from the rare earths quickly, but then in the next step, we isolate the heavies away from the lights. So we have very little processing cost associated with the materials that we don't want. And then by focusing on the heavies, looking at high purity, we're able to process, because of system sizing and economics, we can process relatively small volumes or amounts of material and still be very profitable. And then through TRER, or with the heavy side, the marketing network is being put in place.
Okay, Cameron.
Thanks. We spent a lot of time this last year talking to end users and getting their feedback as we're going along. And you know, the overwhelming message that we've heard is that everyone is looking for an alternative to China. We've talked about that today. They want to ensure that the value chain does not touch China at any point, and they don't want to pay more. And so that is a critical piece. So what we are trying to do, and sort of along the lines of what Jack mentioned earlier, is trying to bring the value chain together. We are not tied to any particular asset. We do have guaranteed feedstock at this stage, but we're in a position where, you know, if we're able to provide the lowest cost and most efficient separation technology, we believe we'll be able to partner with different organizations and those who move along in order to provide the end solution that the market needs.
Okay. Yeah, I think in general, the market is U.S., but the question is, can you compete against Chinese in, I think it's about three or...
We're less than four or three, two.
Yeah. Fair enough. Well, then the question is, it's a horse race.
Well, that's the point. Yeah, right now we're doing internal assessments. Our numbers are confidential, but based on our assessments, we are highly competitive with Chinese material at the low selling prices.
Okay, so at today's domestic price in China in U.S. dollars, so we're all talking the same dollars, everybody can compete,
yes.
Can survive?
Well, I'd say from coming from an analyst background, unfortunately, there's only one producing right now, and that's Linus, and they have a number that they see on a regular basis. All of us here, we only have studies that say one thing, it comes out differently, and I'm sure Linus was estimating a different price as well when you were thinking of going into production. So unfortunately, it's a little bit premature to say, and as well, there is the whole question of, well, somebody's only wants to be doing a the processing versus Linus does the entire thing from A to Z. So how can
Paul,
we really compare everything?
I've done the softball questions to use a baseball analogy. Now he gets to play hardball.
Yeah. So my first question would be to Patrick.
Yeah.
So you said your production cost is $4.
Probably less.
Currently today, or probably less. Today worldwide, we're talking here from mine or to finished product. The cheapest producer in China would be around $7. And yeah, Linus, it's always a moving target, but let's say slightly below 10. If I take just the high one, the 10, in the $10 from mine to oxide, you have $3 to $3.5 from what we call mixed res carbonate to finished product. That's basically what you're doing, because your business is to take mixed res carbonate and separate and produce. So if you are four, you're already not competitive versus what is in place.
No, it's less than that. I mean, I was just trying to give a number. Some people didn't want to disclose what their actual numbers were, and the number was put out as 9, and I said 5, 4, 3. Actually, I think the original number that I said was 2. In the beginning,
yeah, but let me come back to all the you put so many papers here. So we try to avoid going back right and left, so feel free to comment. But for those on this side, it's all about separation,
right?
On this side, it's extraction direct, right?
Yeah.
And same here, and then you do everything. In terms of separation, there is today in the world around 230,000 ton capacity for separation production. So my big question is, a number of you said my number one concern is funding. Funding is never a problem. Natasha said.
Have you seen this market?
Huh?
Have you seen this market?
No, but if your case is good, I listened very carefully this morning. If really you are the best and the ore is in the surface, I know that's what you shouldn't say, etc., then you have money easily. So if you have difficulties to get funding, it means that something is wrong. And I think one thing that is wrong or difficult is that there is twice more capacity than there is demand today. So how do you adjust that in your making your business case to have to have your funding at the end of the day?
Yeah, so funding is obviously a critical piece, and it's a great question. Thank you for asking that. We've received a lot of feedback. Again, we do have an LOI in place right now. We're finalizing our due diligence, so hopefully we'll have that wrapped up. But for us, a lot of the feedback from broader groups in terms of funding was, how do you demonstrate that you can reduce the scalability issue? How can you give us confidence that your technology will scale? So these results are fantastic, but we need data points to prove that. And I think that's a difference that what we see today than we would have a few years ago. So that is why we've aggressively moved forward with our scalability at successive levels, and we are now testing a commercial size cell, and we believe we will have full data points within 60 days. That is very, very clearly the feedback we received in terms of the concern with a new technology. Show us today that it scales.
You're my boss. We cannot have a public argument.
You're a brave man if you say no.
I just want to follow up Paul's question, and I'm coming at this not as someone who's in rare earths at present, but also as, like, I spent most of my life as a marketer. So when I was a brand new baby product manager at Nestle, you know, I was taught about analysing the market and working out which markets we might like to go in. And there we had the rule that, you know, you didn't launch a product unless you legitimately were going to be number one or number two with a legitimate claim to be number one at some stage. Why do you want to enter a market which has got 2.5 times the capacity of the demand at present? You know, I mean, that's what I don't understand.
Is that directed at anyone in particular?
Anyone.
Well, most of the refining.
Spending money on it.
I think one comment on that is about there's maybe all this capacity, but where is that capacity located? Yeah. Then the second aspect is. But the second aspect then is, okay, for a miner, for somebody mining and producing, say, a concentrate, if they are able to work with somebody who has capacity on solvent extraction, you have to get into the issues of consistency of supply, flexibility to adapt to it in the SX circuit. So there's just a number of issues like that we've seen that says, well, if the capacity was right next to the plant, it might be something to consider. And then looking at that thing about the funding, is that the way the world has gotten, and we've seen this not just in rare earths, but every new technology, even though we have continuous ion exchange and chromatography systems in large commercial operations, the question is always, well, I know it works over here. I want to see it work with exactly what I want to do. You know, so it's not, so there is that issue of getting that final pilot plant step to show, okay, it's going to work at full scale.
See, our model is a little bit different. We believe in a centralized refinery process. So, you know, and going back 5, 6, 7 years when I first started talking about this, people thought that you couldn't mix concentrates together and things like that. I had to explain myself through a lot, but I think everyone's come around to the point where, yes, they agree that things can be done that way. It's done that way in China. I'm Chinese, but I'll tell you, I would not trust the Chinese to toll for you. And you don't necessarily want to go with, I'm speaking on behalf of miners now, you don't necessarily want to go with, I think, with the technology with another competing mine. That's why I still think that an independent centralized refiner is the way to go. You've got scale, you've got concentration of engineering and quality control, which is extremely important to end users. I mean, some of these end users, it'll take you years to get in. You might have the greatest product, but it'll take you years just to go through their approval process.
I think there are two schools, if I understand well. The big size school, which is the one of Patrick, and the modular school is yours, and I heard modular here. And obviously, the modular aspect carries less risk and maybe less benefit if it's
we're
fair,
not large. We're
because the size goes together with an investment, so a big risk.
Yeah, but our size, actually, our first one's only 2,500 tons. But it's actually a 2,500 per year ton per year heavies plant. Hmm? It's a heavies plant.
Oh, which so, is good size, no more size, 3,000.
Yeah, so, and ours is modular too. It's easy to expand. Like I said, CapEx is extremely, extremely low. So
the other point is, and Alastair said that I'm a bit corrosive sometimes, so I tried to control myself, but I read the brief you all sent, or not all, Cameron didn't send because the process of Cameron is confidential, but if we enter a market with twice more capacity than demand, okay, we can be modular or make sure that the effectiveness is here, etc. But obviously, listening to my boss, who is always the kind of messy for me, the first thing to do is to grow the market. So the question is more specifically, you have very different technologies for separation compared to existing technologies. Therefore, we can expect a very different outcome in terms of product quality. Can we expect this quality to be so different that they would trigger some market growth, a new demand? From the brief, you all say it's high purity, higher than 99%. Being in the business for a number of years, I can tell you that in Linus, we are very proud to do 99.3.5N on cerium, 4N or 4.5 on lanthanum. Mm-hmm. But basically, to the best Chinese, you say that, they say, well, this is standard. So I just take your high purity statement and probably you need to adjust the numbers. But do you have, in your process, ideas to have products that are different and that can trigger new applications and new demand, and therefore more market? Let's go left first, because
I'll partially to answer your first question, and then what you just mentioned. We see that in a lot of industries. I mean, just because the nameplate capacity is much larger than where it stands today doesn't mean that more won't build. So for example, if you look at potash, there are two major cartels in the world. Well, the nameplate capacity is much more than where they're producing today, but it doesn't stop the majors from building more mines, and they are building them. And there are private equity groups that keep piling money into those sectors, and they keep building more mines. So that question gets asked there, but the majors just keep building more mines and they keep increasing the nameplate capacity and the actual production. So I don't think that always stands as the main goal, no goal in terms of building a mine or building an extra capacity in terms of separation. But at the same time, I mean, if we look at, I think one of the comments came that most of that capacity today is in China, and which is true. But what does it mean it's in China? We don't know if it's green. We don't know if it's properly managed. We want all the end users to be more responsible in terms of where they're getting their material from. So I think we saw that as an example when Siemens signed the deal with Molecorp for a more sustainable, more environmentally sustainable supply. So I think that's one of those things. If you increase the supply and it actually is a cleaner supply, I think the market will absorb it. If it's just another polluting supply and you're building that another plant in China, let's say somebody comes up with that idea, then I definitely agree with you. I'm not sure if there is a point of increasing it. But I think that that goes back to the same point as I was saying before. If you enter the market, not at a huge capacity where you're suddenly flooding the market and you probably won't survive because of that. So if you slowly enter the market, you grow the market as you just mentioned. By growing the market, you guarantee that your scale now works, you demonstrate that it's feasible, and you guarantee most likely that you will be able to build your mine to the full capacity.
I'm going to add something to what Patrick said, is that, you know, 4 years ago, we were all selling concentrate. To who? Who's going to buy concentrate? We all went out and looked at the Chinese and Rhodia, and we realized we couldn't make any money. So that spurred this technology advancement. We all went out and developed our own technologies, because that's the only way to make a buck. I agree with you. You know, the market's going to grow, and that's where the future is. If there's more rare earths available in the market will grow. We'll find
Stop
more
saying my job is easy.
It's very easy.
I guess my question to the...
You are part of the moderators, not...
Okay, exceptionally. Okay.
No, I guess, coming from the marketing background is what challenges or how do you plan to market a material before you go into production?
Yeah, that's the point of Kirill. Kirill said he will sign contract before starting production, which I believe is great, because then after production, believe me, we are very busy. So, but that's a big challenge. So, but I think it's great. And
it's I don't think anything is easy in this industry. You definitely have to figure out how to do it. Probably do it in a creative way. I don't think we can. I'm not there. I definitely would have liked to answer that question with something more concrete, but not sure I can fully answer that right now.
I think it's part of his proof. I mean, we've actually sent out samples of our products to potential customers and say, "This is what we can produce." From a pilot plan. I agree, scaling up has its own challenges, but I think sending samples out to customers and saying, "Hey, this is what we can produce. What do you think?" We've got a lot of feedback, good and bad. But that's where you start. You start that relationship as early as you possibly can to see if they like your products or what they don't like about your products.
Patrick, I know you want to say something.
Yeah, we've got some pretty strong people in our company with experience with magnets. Furcat is obviously a trader as well, and most of you know Gareth, whose background is in magnets. Magnets have shown magnetic elements like praseodymium and neodymium have shown a pretty elastic supply and demand curves. These are elements that, as they go down in price, demand grows. People find more in uses of it. The electrification of transportation, we're just at the beginning. I'm lucky enough to drive a hybrid car, and if you can get into one of these things or an electric car, it's a great feeling not to be dependent on filling up. I fill up every couple months. We are literally at the beginning stages of the end of the petrol economy. I truly believe that. I've also got contacts in China that have said that their next centralized plan is going to focus on healthcare and air pollution, but they're kind of related. And their big plan is to electrify their entire transportation system. They've grown their natural gas import facilities on their coast by 500%. They will be in the next couple of years. Natural gas cogen facilities are the simplest way to produce electricity, which then feeds a transportation system that is based on electric engines, which are 400% more efficient than gas combustion engines. So I think that when prices are low, it encourages more demand, and people come up with more technologies to use magnets. For the first while, I think that it'll be difficult for some of these new mines. I don't really refer to them as rare earth mines anymore. I actually call them neodymium mines because the lanthanum and cerium aren't really worth that much. And it's to be honest, there's a ton of monazite out there that's up for grabs, and it's so simple to crack. You don't need to be a rocket scientist. We'll even give them the technology if anyone wants to start up a monazite refining plant. So it's. I think you've got to chew through a lot of that inventory first.
Yeah, the only question with monazite, obviously, is what are you going to do with the thorium?
With the thorium, but the thorium goes back into their feedstock. I mean, for where they took it out of, you just put it back in tailings.
So you're going to ship it halfway
around
the world?
No, don't ship it. You have monazite facilities and treatment facilities at the mine sites.
Okay.
It's easy to scale. It's not difficult.
So just going off of that, I think if you combine that, the growth in these new technologies, these new energy sources, some of the latent demand that we've heard about today in this conference, you combine that with what I term in real estate as location, location, location. You've got a deposit that's here in the U.S., for example, and you have a green technology to process that. And so you've got a green, low-cost technology combined with some of this latent demand, and I think it can be very attractive to develop some of these resources that we're talking about here with some of the new separation technologies.
Did you have a comment, sir?
I think, too, one of the things, like in our case, and you're talking about, you know, demand expanding and new applications and things, is that one of the areas we're focusing on heavily is making very high purity heavy rare earths, 4-9s, 5-9s, possibly 6-9s. So while some of those markets may be small, you know, they become more niche-like markets. And once material is available, then what happens for further application of that high purity material to replace whatever or to add strength to something? So other applications will happen once you have a material available. It's like the comment, I think it was this morning, about the scandium, you know, the availability of it, and how come the demand, or how come things haven't expanded? Well, it's kind of like, you know, in 1968, there was no demand for PCs or laptops or tablets. Reason being, they hadn't been invented yet. So there was nothing available to look at. So I think a lot of it has to do with that. And that's where I'll call it the risk aspect is of saying, will the high purity materials open up new markets?
Can I comment on a few things? I just wanted to actually circle back to Amanda's question about why enter this market specifically. And I think, you know, the founders of our technology are two PhDs who have focused their entire career on rare earths, and they've got a number of patents in the area, so that's an area of certainly a passion. But I think beyond that, you have to, again, have this business sense. And I think we can probably all agree that separating rare earths are probably the most difficult of everything that's out there. And if you can demonstrate the applicability in rare earths, there are a number of other markets that can open up and be further down the road. You need to stay focused on what's ahead of you, but at the end of the day, you know, look at what makes the most sense in growing a business and understand the markets and what's there. So that's sort of our philosophy around that. You know, in terms of you know, new market applications, you know, again, if there's more out there, is more going to be used. I think, you know, what that implies is that the prices of rare earths are going to be lower. And if you can demonstrate profitability at lower prices, then I think you will see additional applications. But it requires everybody to be profitable at lower prices. And from our perspective, that requires technological innovation. If you can knock off a few dollars a kilogram at separation, that's a big deal in the bottom line.
Yeah, on this one, I think it's great for me. I didn't know there were so many people working on new technologies and rare earth extraction. That's fantastic. I just hope it will continue. Nevertheless, okay, if it's $7 to $10 and you bring down to $5 to $8, okay, it's good. It's a lot of achievement, but it's just $2. Mm-hmm. Today, if you compare, we say magnet is everything. So in magnet making,
yes,
a Chinese will sell a standard magnet at rare earth metal plus $15. This is a very expensive Chinese. The next one would be the best Japanese, would be $25 premium, and others $35, $40. And a gap of $10 to $20 per kilogram of magnet cannot be compensated by savings on rare earth extraction, because you have only 30% rare earth in there. So when the guy say, well, my manufacturing of magnet is $20 more expensive, but now that you're on stream, you can compensate. So, well, you know, if I take market price and a discount by 60, because I have only 30% rare earth, then I'm giving you money for each kilogram of NdPr. And I just wonder, I mean, in the US especially, are there as many people as you seven working on improving or catching up the gap on metal making, alloy making, magnet making? Because this is really big handicap.
For sure.
Yeah.
I'm sure you have ideas.
The US, part of our funding actually went towards some technologies that we that are looking at metal making. The economics are a little bit different when you talk about the heavier elements, like dysprosium. The refining costs for the heavies like Dy and even into the phosphors like the TBEU and the yttrium are a little bit more than a couple bucks. We've started to look at other technologies that are in the metal making, but it's hard to compete against them. There are some plants down in relatively, you know, known safe countries that will toll metal making for less than 13%. So that's a pretty good deal, especially when it you know, if it costs you a lot of electricity.
I mean, there are certainly a number of U.S. companies that are working on metal making.
Alloy, metal is a small piece.
Sure.
Alloy is where they lose already $3 to $5, and magnet $10.
For sure. And we've heard a lot about magnet making in the U.S. today. I mean, there's no question that there's a gap there. And I think, you know, I'd point to, again, what Jack was saying. I guess our philosophy is it doesn't have to be U.S.-centric. I think it has to be outside of China. And it doesn't touch China. And that's the feedback we've received. We're looking for alternatives, to China. And, you know, it has to be similar pricing, and it can't touch it anywhere in the value chain. So if we can find partners and bring that value chain together that's outside China, I think it's going to be a win for everybody.
Like, there is magnetic alloys and strip casters. I mean, the strip casters themselves, you can buy for a couple million bucks. And the technology that goes with them, it's known out there. It's already out there. The strip casters still need a good source of supply of feedstock, of rare earth elements. So I think we already know about one strip caster that's in bankruptcy now, and there's a reason why that those companies are in bankruptcy. So the business for strip casting isn't all that great, but you combine it with a good source of cheap rare earth elements, and you might have a business.
Yeah, I might add that the CMI, the Critical Minerals Institute in the U.S., it's a political agency, but they are funding research in some of the universities. Mm-hmm. So that's going right now. So we hope that something will come out of that in the next few years.
I'm checking for the time, Tracy.
Do we have a question?
We got 20.
20 more minutes.
Yes, 20 more minutes.
Okay, so I can ask a question. I don't know who, but I know a few of you proposed scheme where cerium is separated up front, because cerium is this rarest that I actually personally love a lot. I think it's the most interesting rarest among all of them, but which is abundant or in oversupply today. Now, I would like to, I could challenge this system, but I'd like those who do separate cerium up front to justify economically why it does make sense to eliminate cerium into a product that is not sellable, rather than separating and getting some money for it. How much we save versus how much sales we lose with this? That's the
economics. We cerium comes out last in our process, so we separate it, and so we think capturing. I mean, in our economic models, we give it zero value. So anything above that is a win to our shareholders.
Yeah, we have pretty much the same situation, although cerium, we're rejecting it early. And the basic thought at present is stockpile it, not throw it away, stockpile it.
So and if there zero is. Zero income.
Pardon?
Zero income. You have a warehouse cost.
Yeah,
zero
basically.
Income.
No.
How much do you save?
It doesn't save. It saves some, not a lot, but the thinking being, at least at present, is that if we sold cerium, the amount we would get is kind of one of those things of saying, let's focus on the ones that have the most value and save the other ones for later. That's essentially the philosophy right now. If there's a market, I mean, if somebody says, look, we'll pay a couple of bucks a kilo for cerium oxide, then certainly we'd look at it.
But you would store it as an oxide, or...? What form?
Well, probably a carbonate.
We pull out cerium first as well. I don't know about cost yet, but we pull it out first in extraction, and we precipitate it out in the stripping outside of SX. Our goal was to make we made a 99.7 cerium product, cerium oxide. Haven't found a market for it because we're still in that pilot stage, but we do pull cerium out first. It reduces our mass by 40% going to downstream, so that does reduce the CapEx, OpEx, the other elements.
I don't know why, to be honest, I don't know why people decided to separate the cerium out. I mean, for our business, we charge like a la carte. You go to a restaurant, you say you want this separated, we give you the cost for that. And the cerium, most likely, even though it does save a little bit, I don't know, we'll get you more for that cerium than it probably would cost to separate it out. And we will have customers that can give long-term contracts for those. So even though it is a low-priced commodity, I still think it's worthwhile. I like cerium actually as well, especially at $2 a kilo. And it doesn't really save all that much. I mean, maybe it saves you on some of the material, but shipping material, you know, isn't all that expensive. When you're talking, we're talking a couple hundred tons a year for any particular mine, or maybe even up to 1,000. So it's we will be able to get you a marginal revenue, marginal profit from it.
Yeah, for our technology, because it's selective, we're similar. We can, you know, pick and choose really which rare earth elements we do want to take to the full separation high purity stage, and so we can leave the others together as a group and keep those, or we can separate them out and then keep them to the side, but we can focus on the high value rare earth elements and separate those.
I've got a question here. I've got a postgraduate in mineral economics from the School of Mines in Western Australia, and being in a market where there's double the capacity, that worries me somewhat, but that's cool. Someone once described rare earths, because I asked him, I said, what about it? And he goes, well, it's a black box. Unless you're Chinese or French, you probably can't operate the black box. I say that's different. I say there's some really good, smart guys here concentrating on the process. And I'm just thinking, well, Australia and Canada have got probably 90% of the hard rock lithium deposits in the world, other than mine and one in operation. You know, probably the next best one is Geese. And there's, I know, four or five that, given the opportunity, I'd buy them. Why is everyone concentrating on this? You've got a market like lithium that's growing at 20%. It's in way under supply. There's a market going from 200 to 500,000 tons in 10 years. Like, you can selectively pull stuff out of chloride mediums and stuff like that. Why are you dicking around with this?
Part of it is just a function of the opportunity, and we haven't focused on, you know, a partner for lithium. But I can tell you, we're working with together with UCOR to look at resource companies, including lithium resource companies, and applying our technology to recovering lithium, for example.
You know, entering, I think there's a challenge entering a new market with a new technology. You know, if you're looking at a massive billion-dollar, multi-billion-dollar industry far beyond that of rare earths, they're less accepting of new technologies. When you are in an environment like this that is struggling to compete and be economically viable, technology advancement is the key to profitability. So if you can prove it out in a challenging environment that is a smaller market that is looking to new technologies, I think it becomes incrementally easier to demonstrate, say, hey, come look at this facility. What we did it with the hardest separation that was required. Let's move into this bigger market. That's our philosophy.
Paul, we have a question back here. Can we take this from Judy Baker from Nemaska Lithium?
No. Yes.
Hi, gentlemen. Patrick Wong, you mentioned you believe this is the beginning of the end of the petro industry. So I have actually kind of a three-part question. My first part question, and I'm going to A, B, and C together, and you can answer them as a whole. Do you think Volkswagen's Dieselgate situation is going to impact the rate of change of the decline of the petro industry? What are the key drivers of ending the petro industry? And are there any risks with Tesla's Gigafactory build-out?
Dieselgate, yeah, it's pretty shameful. It could cast a different light on it. I'm going to look like kind of foolish because this has just been something that I've been hitting my head against for like years. And anyone that's seen any of my presentations like 6-7 years ago, I was kind of talking about this, and it's still creeping along. I used to be in a pretty lucrative career, and I left it because I saw this massive arbitrage, and it's the world's largest arbitrage in human history. It is the difference between natural gas and oil. And when I looked at that, it's literally worth trillions. I went and testified, and not testified, but I went and spoke with the U.S. Senate Committee and went through some of the numbers. This is a long time. This is like 6 years ago. And, you know, on a BTU, dollars per BTU basis, natural gas trading at less than $20 a barrel oil. Now, oil now where it is, maybe not such a big deal, but when oil was over 100, yeah, big, big deal. And when you start to look at that arbitrage, you know, oil and natural gas aren't fungible. So you try to connect the dots. And when I started doing that, it pointed towards a number of different industries, of which I left my career and I actually started going into these different industries, the first one being natural gas distribution, because my belief is that the way that these two energy types become fungible is through the electrification of transportation. Yeah, there's a lot of interesting technologies out there with hydrogen fuel cells and all that stuff, but we've seen case and case again where new technologies go by the wayside because of either consumer adoption or just more, it's difficult to build infrastructure. Well, we've got a plug in almost every single, well, we do have a plug in almost every single home out there, and anywhere in between. So the when you connect the dots, it's natural gas, cogen facilities produce electricity. Electricity is now over 90% of the U.S. power grid growth rate. It's not in nukes, it's not in coal. And then that goes towards finding this electric-based transportation system that then buys less gasoline. So long story short, you can't get around, if you follow the money, you can't get around that. It's literally, I'm a good example. Ever since I bought my hybrid car, my electricity costs have hardly gone up at all. But my gas consumption costs have gone down by over, you know, 80%. And it's cleaner for the environment and all that stuff. But without being a tree hugger, it comes down to money. And I actually save money by owning a hybrid car. Programs like this and incentive programs that governments put out to help encourage people buy electric and hybrid cars will help as well. Pan Am Games, I had a green license plate. Everyone else on the 403 was stuck, I was flying by. I would go on the 403 just to get off one exit, just so I can go on that HOV lane. So I think it's inevitable, and it's gonna happen. I've heard that the big three auto companies have a 1,000-kilometer battery, and they just haven't put it out yet because they don't know what it's gonna do to their gas combustion inventory. I don't know if that's true or not. That comes actually from a company that actually makes charging stations. So I think it's gonna happen. What was your third question?
Oh, does anyone
see
any risks for the Tesla's Gigafactory?
It's interesting, I think, Elon Musk is one of my heroes. The decision to go and build something like a gigaplant for battery production is great because you're getting scalability and you're driving. The goal is to drive down unit costs. I think that if the Tesla didn't use induction motors, then he might have actually built something else. And if they do ever plan on using permanent magnets in any decent size, his focus might shift to something else. I don't think it's disruptive. I think it's going to be a great developer of technology, and it's something that is almost strategic now to a point, especially in North America.
Thank you.
Are we done? Okay. Just a small one. I'm very sorry to inform you that Linus should have been part of this panel because we are developing a technology to turn cerium into NdPr. at this moment, we haven't published anything about it because we have to publish first turning lead into gold. But as soon as it's done, so then you are all dead, guys. I'm sorry.
Paul, this is being videotaped.
Thank you.
Thank you.